Yeah. Good evening, everyone. I welcome you all to this AOI Advanced
Series.
Yeah. And today we have the talk on deep neck spaces, the infections as well as the neck dissections, which will be lectured by two of the iconic ladies of our nation. One is from, to start with, Dr. Rupa Vedantam will be talking about the deep neck infections. I think everyone knows her in the country as well as internationally. She is a well-known figure. She's from CMC Vellu. To introduce her, we have Professor Gajanan, who is the director of the Gajanan Hospital. His main interest is in the airway. He's a sleep surgeon as well as an airway surgeon. And then he has done many fellowships in OSA, and also he has presented papers. His main interest in coblation in laryngology as well as tracheal reconstructions, and then he's published papers also. I welcome Gajanan to introduce our speaker today. Over to Gajanan.
Hi friends. Rupa ma'am, Rupa Vedantam ma'am has no need to introduce, but I enlighten some points about her CV. She is very well-known professor from Christian Medical College, Vellore. Her area of interest is about otitis media, epidemiology, complications of otitis media and surgical outcome, then congenital, perilymph and dural fistulas, then inflammatory diseases of sinuses, fungal sinusitis and angiofibroma. Her qualification is MS ENT. She completed her ENT in 1987. She awarded and awarded from childhood. She was very bright child, and during her residency, she get best outgoing student award from Madras University, Dr. P. V. Cherian Award in 1987. Then also get best outgoing student award from IMA Tamil Nadu in 1987. She was professor, she was adjunct professor in otolaryngology in March 2004 to September 2005 in Australia University. Also visiting professor of Lausanne State of Medical State Medical University, USA in 2009. She also get oration in 2011 from AOI Andhra Pradesh in Dr. Kaja Krishnamurthy endorsement oration. She was member of many societies like AOI. Then she was former executive committee member of and life member of Indian Society of Otology. Then she is life member of Cochlear Implant Group of India. She is board of director, International Society of Otitis Media. Then she is member of Fungal Sinusitis Network, life member of Indian Academy of Otolaryngology, head and neck surgery. Then life member of Indian Rhinology Society, like member of Skull Base Society. It's a teacher, undergraduate and postgraduate teacher and examiner since last 30 years. She is faculty in many workshops and on conferences. She also organized many workshops and hands-on dissection. She was invited speaker for conferences and synopsis about 80. She published about 80 to 90 papers in standard journals. She published book, we all know, Emergencies in ENT, that book published by Rupa ma'am. And also she is reviewer in 30 national and international journals, including Laryngoscope, International Journal of Pediatric Otolaryngology and Indian Journal of Medical Research and Laryngology. Now, Madam will enlighten us about neck space infection. And if you have any questions, you can ask write questions in question link. Rupa madam, you can start now your lecture, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gajanan Kashyap. That was very nice of you to say all those nice things. Let me get my... is my presentation visible?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Well, at the outset, let me thank Dr. Samir Bhargava, the AOI president, as well as Dr. M.B. Bharati, who is the AOI president-elect, for inviting me to make this presentation. It's really an honor. Today, I will be speaking on deep neck space infections. And this we know, and I understand that my target audience is the postgraduates. So I will then talk about this infection and its management with an idea that I will be talking to postgraduates here. And we also know that this is a common emergency in many teaching hospitals. So it's something that we really all need to be very aware of as far as deep neck space infection goes. Contrary to popular belief, these deep neck spaces have not been actually created to sort of befuddle the postgraduate at exams. But I hope that with this talk, I'm able to actually make it much easier for the postgraduate to understand, because I'm going to simplify it. So while I am going to talk to you about the deep neck spaces, the first thing I need to do is to tell you about the attachments of this superficial and deep cervical fascia. And that's what I'll do. Then we will look at four common deep neck space infections. Then I will talk to you about the bacteriology, the radiology, treatment, and complications that follow these infections. In general, deep neck space infections, they occur due to certain causes, which we are aware of. In the older patient, you might find dental infection, a long-standing caries tooth may be the cause. In younger children, it's most often due to lymphadenitis or an oral pharyngeal infection, like a tonsillitis. Intraoral trauma could be a cause, particularly in retropharyngeal abscesses, as also foreign bodies. Foreign bodies are an important cause of retropharyngeal abscesses. Now, the infection actually spreads either directly from one space to the other or via lymphatics, and that's important to realize. In general, infections that go across vertically oriented spaces are more sinister than those that just go from one space to the other in a transverse fashion. The cervical fascia, now we'll focus on that. Broadly, it is divided into superficial and deep cervical fascia. The deep cervical fascia is divided into three layers, the superficial, middle, and deep layers of the deep fascia. And this is what I'm going to focus on, but I will tell you a little bit about the superficial cervical fascia too. So here we have the superficial cervical fascia. It extends from the epicranium right down to the axilla and chest. It does not form any deep neck spaces, so that we know. It actually lies in the subcutaneous tissue just adjacent to it, and it includes it actually contains the platysma and the muscles of facial expression. So this pink layer here is the superficial cervical fascia, and deep to that you have the white color deep cervical fascia. Now, as I told you, the deep cervical fascia has three layers, and now we'll consider the superficial layer of the deep cervical fascia. Now, it's a good idea to sort of draw a diagram like this. It makes it so much simpler. And the deep cervical fascia is in white all round. It's also called the investing layer of fascia. So this investing layer, actually, it extends from the nuchal line posteriorly, then attaches to the mastoid, then along the lower border of the mandible. This is all superiorly. The inferior attachment is along the clavicle and the sternum. This fascia actually splits to enclose two important muscles, the trapezius posteriorly and the sternomastoid. Here you have the trapezius and the sternomastoid. It also splits to enclose two glands, namely the parotid gland here and the submandibular salivary gland. It also encloses two spaces. You have the posterior triangle here as well as the suprasternal space of Burns. So, as I said, this fascia is confined to the neck. Then you have the middle layer of deep cervical fascia, and that is denoted by this yellow color. And that layer actually has two layers. It has a muscular layer and a visceral layer. The muscular layer encases the infrahyoid strap muscles, which you can see here. And the visceral layer actually encloses the central compartment of the neck. It encloses important structures like the thyroid gland. And just posterior to this, you have the trachea. Higher up, you have the larynx. Just posterior to that, you have the esophagus. And higher up, you have the pharynx. Now, the fascia that covers the pharynx actually has two layers. The inner layer is called the pharyngobasilar fascia, which you can see here. It is very thick. And you have the outer layer, which is the buccopharyngeal fascia. That is much thinner. So overall, for the middle layer, you have a muscular layer and a visceral layer, and it occupies the central compartment. Now, both the superficial layer as well as the muscular layer give slips of fascia to the carotid canal, okay, the carotid sheath, not so the canal, but the carotid sheath, which contains the internal carotid artery. So you can see here components from the superficial as well as the middle layer. This layer extends from the base of skull right down to the mediastinum at the level of T1 and T2. So it's a very important layer. And then we finally come to the deep layer of deep cervical fascia, which is represented by this green color. And it has two important layers, the alar layer, which is more anterior, and the prevertebral layer. Now, the alar layer lies just posterior to the buccopharyngeal fascia of the middle fascia, that middle layer that we spoke about earlier. And the prevertebral area lies just anterior to the prevertebral muscles, typically the longus coli, as well as the body of the cervical vertebra. Laterally, it is attached to the transverse processes of these vertebrae. This layer extends from the base of skull right down to the mediastinum. And it's an important area because infections from there can actually spread from the neck right down to the mediastinum. Then, as I said, D, you have the carotid sheath. And the carotid sheath is very interesting because it gets slips of fascia from the superficial investing fascia, the white layer, the middle layer of the deep cervical fascia, as well as the deep layer. So, in fact, this fascia that covers the carotid sheath is very strong and makes it resistant to the spread of infection. It extends from the base of skull right down to the arch of aorta. And the carotid sheath contains the carotid artery, the common carotid, and later the internal carotid artery, the internal jugular vein, and the 10th cranial nerve, along with some sympathetics and a few odd lymph nodes. So this really tells us about the three layers of deep cervical fascia. Now let's look at the deep neck spaces that are formed because of these attachments. So there are numerous different classifications of these deep neck spaces. And here I have in front of me a very simple classification, which makes it easy for you to understand. You have the vertical spaces and the horizontal spaces. The vertical spaces run across the entire length of neck, and they are four in number. The horizontal spaces, also called the suprahyoid neck spaces, and they are eight in number. So that's easy enough to remember. And here you have the vertical spaces, namely the retropharyngeal space, the danger space, the prevertebral space, and the carotid space. So let's talk about the retropharyngeal space. This is that space that lies between the buccopharyngeal fascia, which is formed from the middle layer of the deep cervical fascia, and the alar layer, deep cervical fascia. So this is the space that is there. It extends from the skull base to the posterior mediastinum, and it is exactly where you get the retropharyngeal abscess. Then you have the danger space. That's the next vertical space that lies between the alar and the prevertebral layers of deep cervical fascia. This one extends right from the skull base to the diaphragm. So that is why it is called the danger space. And here I will actually show you a case report. This was published by one of the doctors from Command Hospital in Pune. It is part of a case series, and this is one single case where they found that the retropharyngeal abscess actually tracked all the way down to the mediastinum. And here you can nicely see in the CT scan, so contrast enhanced CT scan, you can see the abscess is extending from the clivus up there all the way down to the mediastinum. And this is what you would expect in the danger space infection. Now, as far as the danger space is concerned, the radiologists sometimes use this space interchangeably with the retropharyngeal as well as the deep, the prevertebral space. And so that's something to be kept in mind. But from the ENT point of view, remember that it is a separate space and it is not always affected when you have a retropharyngeal abscess. And then the next space is the prevertebral space. And this is the space that lies subjacent to the deep layer, the prevertebral layer of the deep fascia. And it lies just overlies the longus coli muscle. And it extends from the clivus, as you saw in the previous slide, I showed you in that case, from the clivus right down to the insertion of the psoas muscles. It goes all the way down. So actually, infections of this area are very uncommon. And not really your garden variety deep neck space infection, more often due to osteomyelitis and tumors, you have involvement of this space. Now we come to a very commonly or interesting, very catchily named space, the carotid space, which is also known as the Lincoln's Highway. Now, Lincoln's Highway was the term given by Mosher in 1929, somewhere in 1913. That is before First World War, they had this huge, one of the earliest highways in the United States, starting from New York on the East Coast, going all the way west to the Lincoln's Park in San Francisco. So either because it was such a long highway or because, you know, we know that the carotid sheath, I told you, gets slips of fascia from the layers of the deep cervical fascia, and maybe these intersect and they look like the intersecting roads on a highway. For whatever reason, Moshe is not alive today, so he can't confirm this, but for either of these two reasons, this is called Lincoln's Highway. So it has all three layers of fascia. So it is resistant to infection, but occasionally it can get infected. And that typically occurs in this syndrome, which you should try to remember, Lemierre's syndrome. So sometimes you have children with either retropharyngeal nodes or a tonsillar infection and tonsillar node. They then actually, because the infection is not controlled, it then goes to these few lymph nodes that I mentioned to you lie in the carotid sheath. That then, when it's infected, causes internal jugular vein thrombosis. And then that can actually lead to a patient having a tender neck swelling, high-grade fever, and the complication from this is pulmonary embolism. So it can actually lead on to a very serious infection. Now we'll talk about the suprahyoid neck spaces. And I told you these are spaces which do not actually extend through the whole length of neck. So among them, there is, you can see, a whole bunch of spaces, but we'll just consider a few of them, the common ones. You have the submental space, which lies between the anterior belly of digastric, the hyoid bone, and the midline. And the source of infection is commonly lymph nodes. Then you have the submandibular space, which actually consists of two spaces separated by this triangular muscle, the mylohyoid muscle. So the infection can be either the sublingual space or the submaxillary space. Then you have infection of the masticator space, which is this large space, and I'll talk to you more about it later. The buccal space anteriorly related to the buccinator muscle, the parotid space related to the parotid gland, the peripharyngeal space, which I'll talk to you about in detail later, the peritonsillar space close to the tonsil, and the pharyngeal mucosal space. There are a few other spaces, but these are the most important ones. Now let's look at the submandibular space infections. Now I told you that submandibular space infections, they are consist of infections which are in the sublingual space or in the submaxillary space. Now, they commonly occur from dental infections, I told you. And if you remember the mylohyoid line, which lies on the inner surface of the mandible, the roots of the premolar roots usually lie above the mylohyoid line. So those people who have infections due to a dental infection, they develop infection of the space, which is also called Ludwig's angina. They will have infection primarily of the sublingual space, and then that will track down to the submaxillary space. Those people whose primary tooth infection is in below from the molar teeth, there we know that the roots are actually below the mylohyoid line, and they will then primarily have infection of the submaxillary space, and then therefore have Ludwig's presenting primarily in that manner. So it is useful for you to do a good clinical examination to see which teeth are affected and which spaces are affected. Now we look at the masticator space. Now this is an interesting space which really clinically you will just see as a sort of diffuse cheek swelling. But if you were to look at the CT scan, you will actually identify all the structures in the masticator space. What are these structures? So you can nicely see it in this diagram which I've taken from Orzel et al. This is the pink area, the reddish area. It contains the masseter muscle, the temporalis tendon, the ramus and body of the mandible, as well as the pterygoid, the medial lateral pterygoid, and the inferior alveolar vessels and nerves. As you can see, medial to it lies the parapharyngeal space, and can spread infection from here, can spread to the parapharyngeal space and then subsequently to the retropharyngeal space. In fact, this is one of our patients where the patient actually had infection in the masticator space, but you can see it is already spreading to the parapharyngeal space and the retropharyngeal space. You have the normal site on the right side for comparison to see how different it looks. And then we come to the parapharyngeal space infection. It's a very important type of infection, and so it's important for you to know the anatomy. Now, the parapharyngeal space, as we know from even tumors that occur there, it has the shape of an inverted pyramid, where the apex is at the lesser corner of hyoid and the base is at the base of skull. So it is sort of projects into the back near the region of the maxillary sinus, posterior to the maxillary sinus. Medially, you have the soft palate and the muscles related to that. Laterally, you have the masticator space. So in this picture, actually, you can see it very well, the parapharyngeal space. It has a pre-styloid component anterior to the styloid process and a post-styloid component. So infections from here can spread actually to the retropharyngeal space as well as to the masticator space. And here you can see this patient with a clear-cut Ludwig's angina with involvement of the parapharyngeal space. Both the pre-styloid and the post-styloid components are involved. This is one space that I think you are all familiar with. This is the peritonsillar space. And this space lies just outside the tonsillar capsule. The tonsil, as we know, has a thick capsule, and just outside that is the peritonsillar space. It separates the tonsil from the tonsillar bed, which is formed anteriorly by the palatopharyngeus muscle and posteriorly by the superior constrictor muscle. The peritonsillar abscess is also called Quincy and typically occurs from the upper pole of tonsil. So how common are these abscesses? And so we actually analyzed some of our deep neck space infection. We published this in 2018. We found that these were the four commonest types of deep neck space infection: Ludwig's angina in roughly 1/3 of patients, peritonsillar abscess in little less number, parapharyngeal abscess, and the retropharyngeal abscess. Almost all the patients were adult patients. I compared our series with that from a series from Papua New Guinea. This was published in 2006 in Otolaryngology Head and Neck Surgery. And there you see the authors have actually gone subdivided the infections by age. And you can see again, they too see that Ludwig's angina is more common in the older age group. And some submandibular infections, presumably due to lymph nodes, are in the younger age group. A few words about these neck space, important neck space infections. This is Ludwig's angina. This was one of our patients, a middle-aged lady who had a carious tooth, and this is the common etiology, and it came with this diffuse swelling. Sometimes it can be unilateral and confined to one side. These patients may have fever, odynophagia, neck swelling, drooling, and of course, toothache. The floor of mouth is often raised, and it's important to look at it intraorally, and the neck looks very tense and is tender. If you can do a CT scan, we don't always do it, but if you can do a CT scan, you will actually see the nice collection of pus in the submaxillary space. And this patient obviously has a little more extensive disease. The treatment is required to see if the patient is diabetic or otherwise immunocompromised, has renal failure. Then you also could do an X-ray neck, not so much for the diagnosis of Ludwig's, but really to see if there's any associated retropharyngeal space infection, is there an abscess there, and also to look at the airway, because these patients may have airway obstruction. The treatment is an incision and drainage. Even if they have simple cellulitis, they seem to benefit greatly with incision and drainage, and one should leave an indwelling drain. Some of these patients may require a tracheostomy. You have to give high dose, broad spectrum antibiotics, and preferably do the tooth extraction at the same sitting, which unfortunately your dental surgeon may not be available, but if they are, well, that is a good idea. Then we go on to what I think most of you are familiar with. I think every postgraduate would have seen at least one peritonsil abscess or Quincy, commonly occurs following acute tonsillopharyngitis or trauma. These patients have fever, odynophagia, drooling. The tonsil is pushed medially, and you will see a bit of edema over the anterior pillar and the adjacent soft palate. You'll also see edema of the uvula, and the uvula also is pushed to one side. These patients are again investigated merely to rule out other abnormalities at the same time. The site of infection, as I said, is between the tonsillar capsule and the tonsillar bed, and most commonly the upper pole. So incision, you can aspirate also using a wide bore needle, 18 gauge or so, you can aspirate pus, but you may not be successful, in which case you should do an incision and drainage. And this is well done with a Quincy knife. You can see it has a guard here, which prevents excessive penetration of the sharp portion. If you don't have a Quincy knife, you could use an 11 blade knife and then just put some adhesive across, clean it well with betadine, and then just thrust it as far as the adhesive is. Of course, these patients have to be covered with high dose broad spectrum IV antibiotics. And then you come to the parapharyngeal abscess. As I told you, it's a very important type of abscess in the deep neck space infection, often due to spread from a peritonsil abscess or from a retropharyngeal abscess or just by itself. Patients will present with fever, odynophagia, neck swelling, drooling. Once they develop trismus, then you can be pretty sure that the infection has gone to the masticator space, because that is what is causing trismus. They may have stridor because of severe supraglottic airway obstruction, and lateral pharyngeal wall is pushed medially. It's interesting, you'll find that the tonsil and the pillars are in the correct position, but just posterior to the posterior pillar, you will find a bulge. And so intraoral examination is very, very important. CT scan, this is a contrast enhanced scan, and you can see hypodense areas here representing the pus collection in this patient. Again, blood tests and X-rays may be done. Very useful, but a contrast enhanced CT scan is very often required in patients with parapharyngeal abscess, because the abscess tends to spread rapidly, and you may need to know how the extent of the abscess, and therefore a CT scan is useful. These patients may require an early tracheostomy, so the airway has to be assessed. Incision and drainage intraoral can be done, but is not so, it doesn't yield the pus so well and may not be possible in many patients. And incision and drainage through the neck is what is more commonly done. It should be a nice wide incision, and an indwelling drain should be inserted. Patient should be covered with IV antibiotics. And then we go on to the retropharyngeal abscess. Now, in children, this is typically due to lymph node suppuration. But in adults, often it's due to a foreign body, an ingested chicken bone, which has been neglected and grows on to form an abscess all around it. Or it could be iatrogenic, or it could be infection spreading from an adjacent neck space. Typically, these patients will have odynophagia and frank dysphagia, fever, breathing difficulty, and the neck swelling is typically involving the central compartment, as you can see here. And if you look intraorally, and here again, I would like to highlight the importance of intraoral examination carefully, to which you will be able to see a bulge in many cases of the posterior pharyngeal wall. Now, X-rays are really useful in this type of abscess. And that is simply because there is widening of the prevertebral space. And in this child here, you can see that there is widening of the prevertebral space. And the way we assess widening is that it should be more than 2/3 of the adjacent cervical vertebra. The other thing you will notice is the straightening of the cervical spine. One should also look for a foreign body, particularly in the older patient. Now, in this particular X-ray, what you can see is there's gross widening of the prevertebral space. There is some straightening of the cervical spine. Plus, you can see a lot of air bubbles. The presence of air bubbles suggests the presence of an abscess. And this is often due to anaerobic infection. So you can be rest assured that you should actually be able to get quite a bit of pus drainage when you do an IND in this kind of patient. When you do a CT scan of these patients, if you do get to doing it, you can see compared to the opposite side how a wide abscess is there involving the retropharyngeal space and also actually extending to the parapharyngeal region. Now, very rarely, but you can, and this is one of our patients who had a nice air fluid level. This was a long-standing foreign body. It was a denture, and you can't see it because it was a radiolucent foreign body. And so that is the reason why it remained concealed for so long. But this patient then developed a very big retropharyngeal abscess with an air fluid level. These patients, after drainage, do very well. The treatment is drainage. If, you know, early on, intubation was very difficult in these patients, especially children could often drain under local anesthesia after mummifying the child. But one thing to remember when this is done is to keep the head in a head hanging position because you don't want the child to aspirate any pus. But most of the time, retropharyngeal abscesses can be drained intraorally, but sometimes you might need to make a neck incision. In that case, it's made along the anterior border of sternomastoid. These patients then need to have a tracheostomy in some of them and be covered with IV antibiotics. What is the bacteriology of these abscesses? Usually polymicrobial infection. Anaerobes are more commonly found in adults and those who have dental infections and positive cultures in many diabetics. The gram-positive organisms are usually strep or staph, gram-negative H. flu, Enterococcus, Klebsiella, and E. coli, and anaerobes, the whole host of them, bacteroids, peptostreptococcus, are quite common, especially, as I said, if it's a dental infection. Now, our data is a little different, and that's why I'm just mentioning it here. We actually found that many of our infections were monomicrobial. Now, it's possible that they didn't take treatment elsewhere, and these were mostly local patients. And the commonest organism we found was beta hemolytic strep. All the streptococci that were isolated were penicillin sensitive. There's a busy slide, so I'll just put the gist here. All staphylococci were oxacillin sensitive. And all enterococci were sensitive to gentamicin and ampicillin. So what you notice is they're all sensitive to most of the basic first-line antibiotics that one can give. So in fact, that is what we recommend, that empiric antibiotics should always be the most basic type of antibiotics. You can give IV penicillin, but if you prefer, you could give a broad-spectrum antibiotic. You can start with amoxicillin, clavulanate, and give anaerobic cover if, for instance, it's a Ludwig's angina with a carious tube. But there are some instances where you need to start with a higher generation antibiotic. And in our series, the incidence was 7.1%. And these are patients either diabetic, uncontrolled with large abscesses, multiple abscesses, a patient with mediastinitis or necrotizing fasciitis, or a patient who's been treated in multiple centers outside and then come, definitely doesn't make sense giving these empiric antibiotics. You could start with either meropenem or piptaz, piperacillin, tazobactam, and then obviously take cultures and change the antibiotic based on the culture and sensitivity. Here are some antibiotic dosages. The mean duration of IV treatment is around 7 to 10 days, and following that, one should give at least 1 week of oral therapy. Really, you need to see the progress of your patient, keep seeing the patient every day, and then make your decision on the duration of therapy. And of course, that will require daily dressings of the drained abscess. Now, how are these patients investigated? A basic blood workup to rule out diabetes, renal failure, pus for culture and sensitivity. X-ray of the neck is useful, as I showed you, for retropharyngeal abscess and to look at the airway. Ultrasound really is not of much use, although people have looked at it in great depth. It is useful in some cases of Ludwig's angina if you're not sure if it's just a cellulitis or whether there is a big abscess collection. So for the anterior infections, it may be of some use. Not useful for the posterior infections, the retropharyngeal or the suspected deep danger space infections, so much better. And in mediastinitis also to immediately do a contrast enhanced CT scan of the neck and thorax. The broad principles of treatment, first look at the airway. Patient comes into casualty, is the patient breathing okay? Is the saturation, oxygen saturation adequate? Is the patient hydrated well? Maintain an intake output chart. They may not have been taking anything orally, so they may be dehydrated, may have electrolyte imbalance, renal dysfunction, sugars may not be under control. So check all of that quickly. Do a quick intraoral examination, see if the floor of mouth is raised, there's a retropharyngeal fullness, look for a caries tooth. If possible, do a flexible laryngoscopy. If the facilities are not there, an indirect laryngoscopy if possible. IV antibiotics we went through. Intraoral drainage is preferable for quinsy, for retropharyngeal abscesses and some parapharyngeal abscesses. But by and large, neck incisions are required. For a unilateral Ludwig's angina, incision A should be sufficient. For a bilateral Ludwig's angina, incision B is fine. For a large retropharyngeal abscess, incision C is fine. And then just sometimes you might find a patient with mediastinitis with an abscess in the anterior space, and then you could actually make a horizontal incision in the lower neck, and that could take care of that too. The role of intubation and tracheostomy, this is important for those of you who work in different settings. Those who work in tertiary care centers, patient doesn't want a tracheostomy, you also want to avoid it, you should have good HDU or ICU setting. If the airway is compromised with fiber optic intubation, you have a good anesthetist, you can secure a good airway. Do not extubate at the end of incision and drainage. Keep the patient in the HDU or ICU. Maybe 48 to 72 hours, the patient is fit, the edema has settled, you should be able to extubate and get away without a tracheostomy. But if you don't have all those facilities, it's a much safer thing to go ahead and do a preliminary tracheostomy in a patient with a compromised airway and incision and drainage thereafter. Even in a patient whose airway is not completely compromised, keep watching and have a very low threshold to do a tracheostomy in these patients. You can decannulate as soon as the edema settles and the patient is able to feed well orally. What are the complications of this? Well, airway obstruction, as I told you earlier, aspiration pneumonia, typically for retropharyngeal abscesses, necrotizing fasciitis. Here is this unfortunate lady with necrotizing fasciitis. This is a kind of infection that sort of eats up all the tissues, the skin, the subcutaneous tissue, and then slowly the deep fascia. Should be recognized early and treated with the appropriate antibiotics. If required, a change of antibiotics. The daily dressings, twice or thrice daily. The drain should be secured for proper drainage. These dressings sometimes go on for weeks to months, and the healing may be by secondary intention. But in case it doesn't happen, then you may have to eventually call your plastic surgeon and put a flap and close it. spread to the danger space. I told you about that previous case. Interestingly, that patient had mediastinitis, and mediastinitis can result in even a pericardial and pleural effusion. This is in one of our patients, actually, from a pre-tracheal space, it spread down to the anterior mediastinum. This patient, actually, the drainage was through a neck incision, and that sufficed. Some patients can go on to septic shock and rarely death also. It's not very common nowadays. Now, if you want to read more about the evaluation of these patients, please look at my book, Emergencies in ENT. Chapters 8 to 13 actually cover most of the infections that I talked about. This book is really based on symptoms that patients present with. So if you go by the symptoms, and it's fully illustrative, a lot of pictures of actual patients that we've seen. And this is available on Amazon too. So with that, I will end my talk on deep neck space infections. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to take them.
Thank you, madam. You enlighten each and every corner of neck space infection. You also describe parapharyngeal pre-styloid space in abscess also. Yes. Because now in COVID era, we encounter many of mucormycosis cases. Yes. And pterygoid muscle gate necrosis and pre-styloid space infection abscess is quite common nowadays.
Yes, yes.
Last 4 to 5 months. Very good presentation, ma'am. Madam Shilpa Matthew from Kottayam like to ask, please explain again difference between muscular and visceral layer of middle layer of deep cervical fascia.
Okay, I can just go back to that slide and that will make it easier. So yes. The deep cervical fascia, it's actually the middle layer has a muscular and a visceral layer. The muscular layer actually innervates the infrahyoid muscles, okay? And the visceral layer innervates the important organs, the thyroid gland, the trachea, and superiorly, of course, you will have the larynx. Then posterior to that, you have the esophagus. And superior to that, you will have the pharynx. Now, the pharynx per se has in two important layers, one being the pharyngobasilar fascia, which is the inner layer. And it's very thick and it's very useful. It actually bridges the space between the base of skull and the superior constrictor, the thick pharyngobasilar fascia. And it has the outer buccopharyngeal fascia, which is a much thinner fascia. So these are the two layers of the middle layer of the deep cervical fascia.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Madam, okay. Preeti Hazare from Belgaon like to ask, is there any role of steroid in treatment?
Really no, because these are infections and many of these patients are diabetic. I don't think we've ever had to use steroid. Maybe she's thinking of to reduce edema. No, here infection is what is causing the edema. I think we need to treat with antibiotics. And I don't think there's a role for steroids.
Okay, proper antibiotics is the main focus and remove edema by incision and drainage.
Correct.
Okay. Ma'am, Dr. Yasbi Pukhan from Guwahati like to ask, what is the percentage of immunocompromised patient in your series?
So we had a few patients, not very many. I think the number that we saw was really little. I don't have the statistics right here in front of me. I'll have to go out of the screen to get it out. But it is not as many as all that of patients with immunocompromised. Not that is deep neck and space infections are not so common among the immunocompromised. I mean, they may be there, but they're not very common.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
I think I've kept to my time, Dr. Bharati.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to be certain that I don't exceed the time. If the next
15 minutes before, ma'am. 15 minutes before.
Oh, I see. Okay. according to my watch, it is 7:45. And so I said I will stop at that. But if there are any further questions, I'm happy to answer them. I can't hear you.
No questions, ma'am.
Okay. So then I'll sign off and perhaps
the next... Ultrasound in all the cases?
Pardon? I didn't hear you.
Now you can hear?
Yes, I can. Yeah, I can hear you.
Ultrasonogram in all the cases or like what is your imaging...
Ultrasound, we don't usually do ultrasound. Some cases of Ludwig's angina, which are sort of anterior infection, you're not certain whether there is pus collection or it is a cellulitis. Then ultrasound may be of some use, but by and large, it's not really very useful for these patients. Doesn't give very much information, actually, not more than either clinical or maybe just an X-ray. It doesn't give very much more information.
Madam.
Parotid abscess
also,
it's very difficult to make in the parotid abscess.
Yes.
It's very difficult to make out. So ultrasound has a role there also, I think.
I didn't go through parotid abscess, but yes, parotid abscess too, it is useful, ultrasound. Again, it's, you know, we'll tell you whether there is abscess collection or it's just a cellulitis. But very often we notice clinically itself, patient improves once you give IV antibiotic and there's no necessity for doing an ultrasound. But yes, it could be useful for that, for parotid abscess also. Again, the management of parotid abscess is quite similar to the parapharyngeal abscesses in that you sort of, after assessment, they then can be drained also through an incision in the over the parotid area and drained.
Ma'am, one doctor from Patna, Bhartandu, is asking how to decide for tracheostomy in case of Ludwig angina case.
Okay, so I went through that, but I will just bring up that slide again because that slide actually tells us what the dilemma is with. Let me just go to that slide, tracheostomy. So when you look at tracheostomy, so it really depends on the facilities. Number one, what facilities do you have? Do you have a good anesthetist? How bad is the patient's airway? Is it mildly compromised or maybe moderately compromised? Obviously, if it's severely compromised, there is no question. You go ahead and do a tracheostomy. Now, if it is either mild or moderate, it depends on whether you have a good anesthetist. If you have a good anesthetist, you can have fibroptic and you have good fibroptic intubation facilities, then go ahead and do that. The patient now, a patient may not be able to afford staying in the HDU or ICU for 2-3 days. That also you have to keep in mind. Each day in the ICU will only increase the cost. So if a patient cannot afford all this, it doesn't make sense to go ahead and do fibroptic intubation and unnecessarily, avoid a tracheostomy. But if your patient can afford it, you have a good anesthetist, you can do fibroptic intubation, and tracheostomy is avoidable, go ahead and just do intubation. But remember, the extubation should not be done at the end of the procedure. That is, you do an incision and drainage, you put in the drain, do not extubate, continue the patient on IV fluids and keep the patient in the HDU ICU, monitor, do the dressings, watch to see that the edema comes down. When the edema has come down sufficiently, the patient is able to breathe spontaneously, then you can extubate the patient. For all other cases, I would suggest that a tracheostomy is best, and the sooner the tracheostomy is done, the better. But if, for instance, you find that the patient's airway is not very much compromised, patient has not a very big abscess, you have drained the abscess, there's not too much of edema, then you can actually wait, do an incision and drainage, start the high-dose IV antibiotics, monitor the patient, see whether the swelling has come down. If the swelling has come down, you might be able to avoid a tracheostomy. But if in the course of the management of the patient, you find, say, the next day that actually the edema has worsened and the patient is having breathing difficulty, you can even do an X-ray neck lateral and see whether the airway is more compromised, then go ahead and do a tracheostomy. Again, with tracheostomy, use a tube, which is the inner tube, but preferably have one with a a cuff, because you don't know when you might need to actually give positive pressure ventilation for these patients. And nowadays, all such tubes are available. And once the edema has settled, then you can actually decannulate. So don't keep the tracheostomy like you would do for a malignancy forever, but try to decannulate at the earliest instance. Take out the Ryle's tube and have the patient feed orally. I hope that answers the question.
Yeah. Ma'am, Ashley Alexander from Bhopal asking, yes, which structure divides the parapharyngeal space in pre-styloid and post-styloid?
So it is the styloid process itself divides the anterior portion into the pre-styloid and the posterior, the area behind that, into the post-styloid portion.
Okay. Madam Preeti Hazare from Belgaum asking, incidence of parotid abscess in pregnancy.
In pregnancy, yes. I don't think I have an answer for that, I'm afraid. I don't know how common it is in pregnancy. Is it that common? I'm not aware of it. Well, unless she has seen a lot of that, but I'm not aware of that. It's often seen when there's dehydration, patient, you know, those kind of problems are not so common in pregnancy.
I think it is more of a parotiditis, ma'am.
Correct. Parotiditis is common, parotid enlargement is common, but parotid abscess is not so common.
Madam Dr. Jaya from Trivandrum asking, yes, isn't necrotizing fasciitis a separate, yes, entity rather than complication?
Well, it is a complication of deep neck space infection and can be actually treated, as it can occur due to various causes. You know, it doesn't necessarily have to follow a deep neck space infection alone. You have necrotizing fasciitis apropos of something else altogether. But when it follows a deep neck space infection, then you would look upon it as a complication. Doesn't occur in all patients, is unusual, but important to recognize it, because your management really will have to be that much different when the patient is found to.
Okay. I think we lost the signal.
Hello, Dr. Hello. Rupa.
Ma'am, we have lost signal from Madam's side.
Yeah. I think
there are still some questions, but afterward, ma'am will explain that questions after she joining. I think we will continue. We should continue next lecture.
Okay. I thank Dr. Gajanan for moderating this session. We'll thank Rupa once she comes back. It was an excellent talk, Dr. Rupa. Now the next speaker is Dr. Deepa Nair, who will be introduced by the moderator, Dr. Yashvir. Yashvir is very VIP person amongst us. He is the associate editor of our journal. I welcome Dr. Yashvir. His academic position is associate professor in Gandhi Medical College, Bhopal, and his main interest is in anterior skull base surgery. Yashvir, over to you.
Thank you, ma'am. I'll be introducing one of the dynamic cancer surgeon from Advanced Cancer Center of Tata Memorial, Mumbai, Dr. Deepa Nair. She's working as professor there in the division of head and neck oncology. She did her MS and DNB in 2006 from Mumbai University. And her special area of interest is in skull-based tumors and its surgeries, with also minimally invasive head and neck surgeries. She has been awarded with multiple awards, many awards, right from her PG days. She was awarded the President of India Award for Gold Medal, Dr. Shankar Dayal Sharma Gold Medal, and first place in MS examination, Kameshwaram Gold Medal, and the Vice Chancellor's Award. So right from her PG days, multiple awards. She was also awarded travel fellowships by the European Skull-Based Surgeries. So best for the PGs, because she was best from right from a PG days, so she'll know best what PGs would require, you know, postgraduates to crack and be the best in the field. So over to you, ma'am. Please start your presentation.
Thank you to AOI and Dr. Samir Bhargav and the entire team who have invited me for this lecture. I'm truly honored. My mandate today is to explain neck dissection to postgraduate ENT students. I've tried to keep it as basic as possible with a lot of videos showing the surgical steps of neck dissection and some theory behind neck dissection. So let me just share my screen. Is the screen visible?
Yes, it's visible, ma'am.
I would not know whether there's some hitches on the end of the video clips, especially. So if you could just give me a feedback in case something is not playing properly.
Okay, fine, ma'am. Fine.
Thank you. So how I plan to take this talk today is I'm divided into multiple sections. Anatomy of neck nodes, need for neck dissection, how neck dissection has evolved around the times, what are the steps of neck dissection, and we'll explain step by step different level neck dissections. What do you mean by adequacy of neck dissection? What are the common complications after neck dissection? And just a brief on what are the indications and evidence today for neck dissection, as no talk is complete without looking at literature review. So let's start off with basic anatomy of neck nodes. After a wonderful lecture on deep spaces of the neck by Dr. Rupa, I think all of y'all must be familiar with the division of the neck nodes into various levels. Now, this has been proposed for almost 3 to 4 decades. And the main reason why this proposal was done was just to simplify the nomenclature and keep everyone on the same page as to, if we talk about that we've removed level 1A nodes, we know that we are talking about a particular group of nodes. Now, let's just take this for, because again, it's a PG lecture, so let's just simplify it. So the neck level node levels are dissected into, differentiated into 7 levels. 1A is the nodal group, which lies between the 2 anterior bellies of the digastrix and the hyoid. 1B is the nodes which are in between the anterior and posterior belly of the ipsilateral digastric muscle. Level 2, 3, and 4 are the jugulodigastric and the jugulo-omohyoid lymph nodes. Again, now these are divided into 3 levels by the lower border of the hyoid and the lower margin of the cricoid cartilage. So level 2 being from the skull base or the jugular fossa up to the lower border of the hyoid, level 2B being from the lower border of hyoid to the lower border of the cricoid, and level 4 being from the lower border of the cricoid up to the clavicle. Now again, structures, the nodal levels are again divided into further levels, like level 2 is divided into level 2A and 2B by the spinal accessory nerve. And again, the spinal accessory nerve divides the level 5 into level 5A and 5B. 5B being below the level of the exit of the spinal accessory nerve, and level 5A being above it. Now, level 6 is what we also call as the central compartment of lymph nodes, which is the lymph nodes between the carotid sheath laterally and the trachea in the midline. So this compartment on both sides is level 6, and it's very important when you think of lymphatic drainage of the thyroid and the larynx. And level 7 is between superior mediastinum, between the great vessels. So these are the levels of lymph node metastasis. That's important because every cavity of subsite of cancer in the head and neck will have different lymphatic nodal drainage. For example, in level 1A will drain basically the lips, the anterior tongue, and the anterior gingiva. Level 1B will drain most of the gingivobuccal sulcus, some amount of the cheek. Level 2 drains the posterior part of the tongue, the oropharynx. Level 3 mainly drains the oropharynx and the supraglottis. Level 3 and 4 will drain the laryngohypopharynx and some amount of the thyroid. The first echelon nodes of the thyroid will be in level 6, and nasopharyngeal cancers will basically drain into the level 2 and level 5. So it's important to know these neck nodes, because involvement of these neck nodes will sort of give you an idea where the primary is involved. Now, what do we mean by neck dissection? Let me just try and minimize this here. Okay, so neck dissection is basically removal of all lymphatic nodes and all lymphatic contents and fibrofatty tissue on the neck for the purpose of treatment. The extent of removal is being decided by various factors like the stage of the disease and the type of cancer. Now, why is this neck dissection so important? Remember, in cancer of the head and neck, the involvement of nodes or presence of nodal disease, either radiologically or clinically, is considered as a single most important prognostic factor, because presence of nodal disease decreases survival by 50% in most squamous cell carcinomas of the head and neck, and immediately upstages disease to stage 3. And if you follow the TNM staging, you know that stage 1 and stage 2 are early cancers, whereas stage 3 and stage 4 are considered as advanced cancers. So this means that if you have a nodal disease, immediately the patient will require multimodality treatment because the patient has advanced disease. Again, if the nodal disease is involved with extranodal extension, that is, disease has spread outside the capsule of the node, the person's survival reduces another 50%. And even in patients whom clinically there's no node, pathologically or microscopically, nodes may be present in 20 to 30%, especially in oral tongue cancers. So understanding the management of neck nodes is very important. Now, neck dissection has evolved over the ages, and it's almost 120 or 140 years since neck dissection has been understood and involved as a surgical technique. Even in the late 1847s, Joseph von Sellius had actually first described that there was the spread of disease of head and neck cancers to cervical nodes, and the patients who had neck nodes had a poorer prognosis, which is what we know as well now. Cocker was one of the first to describe an incision. As usual, Cocker has a lot of things described after him. A Y-shaped incision for neck dissection was also described by Cocker in 1880. Packard said that along with the submandibular nodes, you should also remove the submandibular gland. Buchlin in 1885 was the first to actually show that if you resect the cervical lymph nodes in tongue cancers, you have better survival compared to removing only tongue alone. And that has been proven over the years. Now, the first actual description of radical neck dissection as a procedure was done in 1888 by Jawdinski. But because it was published in Polish, it was really ignored by English literature. And rightly or wrongly, the description has been attributed to Kreil. George Washington Kreil Sr. was the one who first really systematically described radical neck dissections as a procedure. He said that the collar of lymphatics of the neck form an extraordinary barrier through which cancer rarely penetrates. Every part of this barrier is surgically accessible, and hence you should do neck dissection.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Hayes Martin, who's known as the father of head and neck surgery, was the first to describe it in detail. Over 59 pages was published in Cancer in May 1951, and he was the one who systematically described the various techniques of neck dissection and condemned saving the spinal accessory in any stage. Functional neck dissection. Suarez Really was actually the father of functional neck dissection, where he described a surgery not as radical as that described by Hayes Martin, and said in his Spanish language, again, because he didn't publish in traditional English literature, for a long time, functional neck dissection was acknowledged as Boca's contribution to the science. But it was actually Boca who went to Suarez, observed his cases, and came back to his center in Italy and operated the same. So a joint sort of effort or acknowledgement of Suarez and Boca is understood to be behind the concept of functional neck dissection, which is the surgery which is performed more frequently nowadays. Now, the evolution of neck dissection has continued over the ages, and Jatin Shah, as most of you would know, was the one who really described the lymphatic drainage pattern. There are beautiful papers from Memorial Sloan Kettering on there. The AOHNS has actually standardized neck dissection terminologies in 1991, and they reclassified it in 2002. Now, from major radical neck dissections, we are trying to go towards smaller neck dissections, sentinel node biopsies, and super selective neck dissections. So again, the classification of neck dissection from the 1991 dissection classification, where we had various definitions of different types of neck dissections, now we've moved to a more simplified classification where you have either a radical neck dissection where all the lymphatic fibrofatty tissue, spinal accessory, the internal jugular vein, and the sternocleidomastoid are removed. A modified radical neck dissection where all these structures are preserved. Selective neck dissections where nodes of certain levels are removed and described in parentheses, denoting which levels or sublevels are removed. And extended neck dissections if you've done beyond a conventional neck dissection. So moving on to what the steps of neck dissection are. The first, when you talk about any surgery, is how you plan the incision. And similarly, it's important in the neck. Now, luckily, the head and neck is very blessed with good vascular anatomy. When you look at the neck skin anatomy, it is very peculiar because you have the blood supply, which are the main blood supplies, are superiorly by the occipital artery, anterior superior by the facial branches, the submental branch of the facial nerve, inferiorly by the transverse cervical artery and the supraclavicular arteries. So basically, there's a watershed line in the center of the neck and in the midline, and these are generally avascular planes. And based on this arterial blood supply, incision planning has to be taken into consideration, because if you do not plan your incisions around the watershed line, then you won't have proper wound healing. Of course, there are other factors which determine what is your incision you're going to use for the neck dissection, mainly depending on the type of neck dissection, the primary which has to be addressed, whether it's oral cavity cancer, whether it's a laryngopharyngeal cancer. If there's skin involved either by the primary or by the node, the incision changes accordingly. Any planning, like reconstruction which you have done after, you're planning to do after excision of the primary. For example, if you're planning a submental flap, then the neck dissection obviously gets altered to accommodate the flap harvest before you do the neck dissection. And prior treatment, scars, radiotherapy will again change your incision. Now, there have been various neck dissection incisions which have been described, the double Martin, the Y, the Cocker's incision, the H incision, Conley's incision, McPhee incision. But most commonly nowadays, what we follow are a standard horizontal neck incision in the most prominent crease around 2 to 3 fingers breadth below the angle of the mandible. This horizontal neck incision is actually enough to access the complete neck, especially if you're doing a selective neck dissection. If you are going to do a Kreil's incision or a Schobinger's incision, this gives you better access to the lower part of the neck. And the McPhee incision is used in some cases where you've taken a horizontal incision superiorly and a horizontal incision inferiorly, keeping this skin intact. This is especially used in post-RT settings. once the neck incision is marked and infiltrated, here we are doing just a larger horizontal incision. The incision is deepened, cutting the skin and platysma almost at the same layer. Using skin hooks, the skin is retracted and dissection starts in the subplatysmal plane, hugging the platysma, making sure that all fibrofatty tissue stays down on the specimen site. Now, this plane is a very good plane. And if you stay in the correct plane, you will be able to really dissect without having too much bleeding, because the vascularity is between the skin and the platysma and underneath. So if you stay in this plane, as I have shown here, you get a very good elevation of the subplatysmal flaps. Now, when you are raising the flaps, you have to be careful that you do not injure the external jugular vein, the common facial vein, or some communications to anterior jugular veins. After elevating the superior flap with subplatysmal layers, the next is to elevate the inferior flap right up to the clavicle. Then anteriorly, if you are going to take a Kreil's incision, you have to elevate. And if you remember, I had told you there's an avascular plane in the anterior, in the midline. So when you are elevating the subplatysmal flap, you have to elevate it in an area which does not dig into the subcute area, because as you see, there is a avascular plane. This is the platysma of the opposite side, and you need to be sure that you do not buttonhole or go too close to the skin so that there's no skin necrosis in this patient. This elevation is done so that the opposite belly of the digastric is exposed. This completes your raising of the subplatysmal flaps. Once you have taken the subplatysmal flaps properly and secured the skin flaps with stays, sutures, flap stitches, whatever you call, we normally take non-absorbable sutures like linen or mer-silk as stay sutures. We take at least two on top and two below so that the plane is widely open, the field is widely open for dissection. Then the level 1A dissection is started. Now, like I told you, the level 1A is the area between the two heads of the digastric, the anterior bellies of the digastric, and inferiorly, it goes up to the hyoid. That's the hyoid which I'm palpating. So all the fibrofatty tissue between these two anterior bellies of the digastric has to be completely removed, starting right from the mandibular tip. We tend to use a monopolar cautery. I use a Valleylab cautery with settings of around 25, which is a fulgurate setting in the Valleylab. You have to be very careful that you do not resect the muscle along with it. If you are in the correct plane, you can easily lift up all the fibrofatty tissue, leaving behind the muscle back. You have to pick up the fibrofatty tissue, which is covering the muscle, leaving the muscles bare, but not resect the muscular fibers along with it. And if you're in the right planes, the tissue really comes off very easily. Now you have to be careful because sometimes nodes in this area will have extranodal extension, and there may be some involvement of the muscles below. In such a case, please resect some part of the muscle fibers so that you get an adequate cuff of tissue around the neck node. There is generally a small branches from the facial artery branches to the mylohyoid, which may give a terminal branch in this area, which bleeds sometimes. You need to buzz it, coagulate it, ligate it. Most of the times it just gets coagulated by a cautery, either a monopolar or a bipolar. And that completes the level 1A resection when you round off the the specimen at the hyoid. When you start level 1B dissection, the most important thing is to identify the marginal mandibular nerve. So the dissection starts at the lower border of the mandible I apologize for the color. Something is off in this video. So this is the lower border of the mandible. You can see some tail parotid tissue here, and we start identifying it. This dissection is always done with scissors or a mosquito, never with a cautery. You identify the the facial plane. And remember, the marginal mandibular nerve is within the submandibular fascia, superficial layer of the submandibular fascia. You have to really incise it. Irrigating the area actually gives you better visualization, and we tend to use irrigation a lot. Keep your field dry. And if you have small bleeders like this, always use bipolar cautery and not a monopolar cautery to coagulate, so that you do not cause any thermal injury to the marginal mandibular nerve. Now, there are two ways to identify and preserve the marginal mandibular nerve. The conventional way is either do a dissection like I showed you. You follow the marginal nerve starting from the angle of the mandible, tail of parotid, and identify the nerve in the submandibular fascia, expose it and follow it below. The other technique is to just identify the facial vessels. You can see the facial artery and vein out here. Loop the facial vessels and then ligate it. Keeping the ligatures long, if you loop the vessels, you are going to retract the nerve without causing injury to it. This technique is called the Hayes-Martin technique of identifying and preserving the marginal mandibular nerve. Now, sometimes, especially in buccal mucosa cancers, there's likely to have nodes, as you see in this case, perifacial nodes which lie along these facial vessels and around the marginal mandibular nerves. Do not preserve the marginal mandibular nerve Do not preserve the marginal mandibular nerve and try and preserve. Let me just go back. For some reason, the video is skipping. Okay, so the point is that if there are perifacial nodes, please dissect out the perifacial nodes completely and do not try to preserve the marginal mandibular nerve. Just because you want to preserve the marginal mandibular nerve, do not leave nodes behind. These nodes can cause a recurrence which may not be salvageable. Once you have preserved the marginal mandibular nerve in its entirety, then you can actually go on to do level 1B dissection. Now, like I said, level 1B is the area between the anterior belly and the posterior belly of the digastric, and that's where your dissection should proceed. So if you see here, this is the anterior belly of the digastric. This is the mylohyoid muscle, which is under this. And you have to remove all the fibrofatty tissue starting from between the anterior belly of the digastric, the mandible, and the mylohyoid. The dissection continues gently posteriorly, pulling the tissue posteriorly. There are branches of the facial artery to the mylohyoid muscle, which may cause troublesome bleeding, which needs to be coagulated. The dissection continues inferiorly along the tendon of the digastric muscle, raising all the fibrofatty tissue, nodes, and submandibular gland all along from an anterior to posterior direction. Like I said before, the facial artery can be either clipped or ligated, releasing the submandibular gland and the submandibular nodes into the specimen. Dissection continues under the surface of the mandible, taking all the fibrofatty tissue down. Now, that's your marginal mandibular nerve, and what we are trying to show you is the relationship of the lingual gland, the lingual nerve, the hypoglossal nerve, and the submandibular duct. So the submandibular duct is divided between the lingual and the hypoglossal nerves releasing the submandibular ganglion going posteriorly. This patient had extranodal extension at level 1B, and that's why there was increased vascularity and bleeding at this level. If you see, this is the posterior belly of the digastric. We are releasing all the submandibular gland and nodes from the posterior belly of the digastric posteriorly as well, continuing the dissection. The only vessel which will come above the posterior belly of the digastric is the facial artery. Once we identify and ligate the facial artery again, as seen here, in this case, we were doing a free flap, so we kept a longer stump of the facial artery and ligated it with clips rather than with ties, because these vessels were going to be used for microvascular anastomosis. So keeping a length of facial artery, we dissect the node out, and that completes level 1B clearance after dissection of the facial vessels. Once level 1A and 1B are completed, the next level we need to move to is the level 2A. Now, the level 2A is between the posterior belly of the digastric and up to the level of the hyoid. So the most important structures in this level are the spinal accessory nerve, the internal jugular vein, and the digastric muscle, which form a triangle as demonstrated here. The way to dissect is to retract the sternocleidomastoid behind, identify the posterior belly of the digastric, identify the spinal accessory nerve, again taking time to do blunt dissection with a mosquito and scissors, exposing the spinal accessory. Do not use cautery near the spinal accessory nerve.
We can't hear you, ma'am.
Deepa, we have lost you.
We have lost signal from her side, ma'am.
Yeah, no signal. I think today we have a little signaling problem. Connectivity issue is there. Hello, Deepa? Is Rupa Vedantam back?
Hello, Madam Bharti, Madam.
Yeah,
ma'am, we can hear you. Yes.
We can hear you. You can start sharing your screen.
Yeah, so I've had a power cut, so the video will not, I mean, I'll try sharing my screen. I'm on mobile data. I'm not sure how much will run.
Okay.
I'm closing my video for that reason, so that at least the data, on the data, the presentation can run.
Yeah, yeah.
Sorry about that. Can you tell me till what slide did I reach?
Level 2. From
level 2 and spinal accessory.
Okay. So, the spinal accessory, as we saw, is the important structure in level 2.
No, you have to start sharing your screen.
Oh, I have not started sharing my screen. Sorry about that. Yeah, can you see the screen now?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, sorry for the interruption. I've had a power cut at my house and I'm working on mobile data now.
Yeah.
So the spinal accessory is again the most important portion in level 2. And the spinal accessory is basically arises from the jugular foramen and crosses the sternocleidomastoid muscle from medial to lateral in 70% of the times from under the surface of the digastric and above the internal jugular vein. In 30% of the times, the spinal accessory can arise behind the internal jugular vein. And in 3% of times, it can come in between the two branches of the internal jugular vein, like in this case. So remembering that these may be particular patterns of anatomy of the spinal accessory nerve during dissection is important to avoid inadvertent damage to the nerve. Now, when we are clearing level 2, it's imperative to avoid using cautery near the level 2. Here, you're releasing the tissue below the level of the spinal accessory nerve. I'm sorry, the video is not very great, but here you can see the spinal accessory nerve. As long as you're not near the nerve, you can use cautery, but near the when you are towards the nerve, please do not use cautery. Use scissors and bipolar. The clearance of level 2 should be done from the posterior belly of the digastric, the sternocleidomastoid, and clearing this triangle medially to this spinal accessory. All this tissue, leaving there the muscles, is important to clear the spine level 2B completely. One thing you have to be very careful while clearing levels 1A, 2A and 2B in elderly patients especially is that the ICA may be atherosclerotic and very prominent, something what we call a carotid knuckle. Now, when this is covered by fascia or tissue, it can be easily mistaken for a node and inadvertently injured. Also, these patients, if you handle this carotid bulb too much while doing surgery, you may cause a vasovagal attack. There may be bradycardia, syncope, or even an atherosclerotic plaque can actually break off and go as a thrombus and cause strokes in the postoperative period. So do not handle the carotid bulb too much during a neck dissection. Now coming to level 2, 3 and 4 clearance. Now this clearance can be done with a combination of scissors, bipolar, monopolar. What is important is to palpate like I showed you and open up the carotid sheath. Now, by opening up the carotid sheath, you are sure that you're going to not damage the carotid vessels. You have to take up all the fibrofatty tissue along the jugular digastric and jugular omohyoid nodes. Laterally, near the spinal accessory nerve, I tend to use scissors and bipolar to avoid thermal injury to the spinal accessory nerve. All the fibrofatty tissue, including nodes, are resected, retracting the sternomastoid laterally. Now dissection continues, taking the tissues from lateral to medial. Again, you can see all fibrofatty tissue is dissected out, but all the cervical rootlets and proprioceptive nerves of the cervical roots, C1, C2, C3, C4, are all left behind. Now, this is important because some of these proprioceptive nerves give communication to the lower portion of the spinal accessory. When you go down to level 4, retract the lower belly or inferior belly of the omohyoid, clear all the tissue right down up to the transverse cervical artery. That's the lower extent of your neck nodal dissection. All the nodes are cleared and you can see the transverse cervical artery glistening under the fascia there. The nodal tissue is retracted from lateral to medial. Again, at this point, be very careful that that nerve which I've cut is a supraclavicular sensory nerve and not a motor nerve or a functional nerve. Dissection is continued. And along the internal jugular vein, all the nodal tissue, you can use either a cautery as I'm using, or a knife or steles to resect and clear all the nodal tissue along the jugular digastric, jugular omohyoid nodes along the carotid sheath, leaving the internal jugular vein bare. Be careful to, if you're using a cautery, not to puncture a hole into the IJV at this point. If you have any branches, you can ligate it. After clearing level 2, 3, and 4, the only thing which remains to be cleared in a modified radical neck dissection is level 5. Now, the most important anatomical landmark in level 5 is the spinal accessory nerve. And the spinal accessory nerve is identified at Erb's point. Now, what is Erb's point? Erb's point is where, the posterior border of the sternocleidomastoid muscle, where the greater auricular, the transverse cervical nerve, exit and go around the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So around one, this junction is called the Erb's point. The spinal accessory nerve is generally found 1 centimeter above the Erb's point, and it can go. It goes along the anterior border of trapezius up to about 5 centimeters above cranial to the clavicle. Now again, to identify, sorry, for some reason my video is not playing. So now this is the, if you see, this is the greater auricular nerve, this is the spinal accessory nerve, this is the external jugular vein, this is the posterior belly of the sternocleidomastoid, and these are nodal tissue. And once we have identified the spinal accessory nerve, we are going to dissect and clear all the nodal tissue around it. Sorry, my slides are just skipping. So again, like I said, when you are dissecting in this area, be very careful not to use monopolar cautery near the nerve, because you do not want to cause any thermal injury to the nerve. All tissue should be dissected on both sides, especially like in this case where there's nodal disease lateral to the nerve in the posterior triangle of the neck. I'm using a mono cautery and bipolar cautery and scissors to actually clear all this tissue. Do not leave any nodal disease behind, because that will cause recurrence, which may not be salvageable in the post-op case. All this tissue is cleared, and that's how level 5 clearance is done and the neck dissection is completed. Now, there are some certain things of anatomy which we need to remember when we are doing neck dissections. One is the thoracic duct, especially on the left side. The thoracic duct is basically the carries chyle from the intestines and empties most commonly into the internal jugular vein. Sometimes the entry point is lower down into the subclavian internal jugular vein junction, sometimes into the external jugular vein, and most very rarely into the subclavian vein. But you have to recognize this, especially when you're doing level 4 clearance in left side, to avoid injury to this thoracic duct and cause a chyle leak. Rarely, you can also see it in the right side, as in this case, this is a lymphatic duct. In the right side, you can identify this glistening structure, which is slightly opaque. This is the lymphatic duct. Identification and preservation of the structure is important during neck dissections. Another important nerve to preserve is the phrenic nerve, which arises from the C2, C3. It arises on the anterior surface of the scalene. It is under the prevertebral fascia and posterolateral to the carotid sheath. So when you're clearing levels 3 and 4, be very careful to not breach the prevertebral fascia to preserve the phrenic nerve. Again, the transverse cervical artery arises from the thyrocervical trunk. It is in the lower part of the neck dissection and is the lower boundary of the neck dissection. Now, this is important because the transverse cervical artery gives a ascending branch which goes up and supplies some of the tissue in the lower part of the neck. One of the most commonest cause of bleeding in the postoperative period is this bleeding from an unsecured ascending branch of the transverse cervical artery. It's important to ligate this ascending branch, but try and avoid ligation of the transverse cervical artery. A lot of flaps like the supraclavicular flap is also based on the cervical artery. So preserving this artery is important for reconstruction point of view as well. Brachial plexus, it's very difficult and very rare to cause injury to the brachial plexus in a neck dissection because it is lateral to the phrenic and again under the prevertebral fascia between the scalene muscles. If you really go deep beneath the prevertebral fascia, only then you can injure the brachial plexus. Be very careful when you are working in this area, especially level 4, level 5, and keep your prevertebral fascia as your anatomy standpoint that you should not go underneath to avoid injury to this. Now, coming to the indications and type of neck dissections. So when you have a N0, that is a neck which is clinically and radiologically node negative, the type of neck dissection which is done is a selective neck dissection. Now, again, what is, like I said right at the start, depending on the propensity of the primary disease to metastasize, the neck dissection is done according to that. So for oral cavity, the most common levels of neck clearance are the levels 1, 2, and 3. In larynx and hypopharynx, we would do 2, 3, 4, and 6. For thyroid, we would do level 6 and sometimes level 2 to 4, and oropharynx level 2, 3, and 4. If the patient has nodes present in the neck, then again, if the patient, depending on the involvement of structures, you would do either a modified radical neck dissection, which is more commonly done. Rarely for an N3 node, which is fungating or stuck to structures like the internal jugular vein or the spinal accessory or the hypoglossal, would you do a radical neck dissection? Most of the times, you would end up doing a modified radical neck dissection. How do you know that your neck dissection is adequate or not? Well, if you remove at least 18 nodes in your specimen, then you know that your neck dissection is supposed to be adequate. And this has been seen over time in different series and papers that if there's at least 18 nodes dissected, then it is predictive that you will have improved survival and lower rates of locoregional failure. So as surgeons, a completeness of neck dissection could be one of the prognostic factors for patients with head and neck squamous cell carcinoma. Now, coming to the complications, there are lots of complications listed in the textbook. As head and neck surgeons, we see each of them sometime most frequently would be wound-related complications. You can have the nerve injuries. Kyle leak is seen around 5% of the times. Vascular complications, thankfully, are very rare. And lymphedema is something which is there, but very underreported in head and neck literature. Now, the most common complications are scars. Now, scars like these are due to improper placement, not following meticulous techniques, not closing the platysma properly, the skin properly, post-op infections, seroma formations. So if you want to avoid scars, we have discussed already that you should try and place neck incisions in natural skin lines or relaxed skin lines and always do tension-free skin closures. Shoulder dysfunction syndrome, it's basically due to injury to the spinal accessory nerve, and that's why dissection of level 2 and level 5 is avoided by some surgeons if the patient is clinically node negative. Because the incidence of painful shoulder syndrome is in 15 to 20%, even if in patients who have undergone just a selective neck dissection. Now, the various etiologies for this are most likely to be either traction injury or thermal injury due to cautery. And that's why take all the steps, like I mentioned, no thermal injury, no using monopolar cauteries, no retracting the nerve or looping the nerve during surgery. Prevention is better than cure, and you should initiate early postoperative physiotherapy in these patients to reduce postoperative shoulder dysfunction. progressive resistance exercise training, or PRET, is also found to be effective in certain cases to reduce postoperative shoulder dysfunction. Kyleic occurs less than 5% of the times. Rarely, in 1/3 of the cases, it can be on the right side. Most common found in the left side. You have to check intraoperatively by doing a Valsalva's maneuver. That is, you ask the patient anesthetist to do a forced Valsalva on the patient, keeping the patient in a Trendelenburg position. An additional maneuver can be the Sarnia's maneuver, where you give additional abdominal pressure to the patient. And then you will be able to see if there's any leakage intraoperatively. What happens postoperatively if you have Kyleic? You will have milky drain fluid in your drain. Your drain will be high. If it is more than 500 a day, you have to explore the patient. If it is less than 500 a day, you can try conservative measures like keeping the patient on fat-free diet, medium chain triglycerides, reducing the amount of suction on the drain, keeping the drain only as a dependent drain. But that can be taken at some other day. Vascular complications, like I said, mostly are related to improper techniques, slipping of ligatures. Very rarely you'll have IGV bleeds or rents due to injury to the internal jugular vein. And carotid blowouts, by and large, are rarely seen nowadays. Most of the times when they are seen are due to either tumor involvement or rarely due to pharyngocutaneous fistulas in prior treated patients with radiotherapy. What are the contraindications of neck dissection? You should not do a neck dissection if the carotid artery is encased more than 180 degrees, if there's infiltration of the prevertebral fascia or the muscles of the prevertebral space, if there's disease into the parapharynx, or the primary is unresectable, or the patient has extensive distant metastasis. Now, just a brief overview of what is the literature on neck dissection. Just remember the papers. The most important papers for PGs will be the first randomized controlled trial on neck dissection was done from India, was done by Dr. Fakih at Tata Memorial Hospital, where he looked at whether you should electively treat the neck by surgery or just do it when the patient develops a node. And in this patient, they found that patients who had undergone an elective neck dissection, which was a radical neck dissection in those times, had better survival. Another important point in the study which was brought about, that if you have a tumor which is more than 4 millimeters, you have a higher chance of nodal metastasis, and that's why it's better to treat with neck dissection. Another seminal paper from Jatin Shah's group, this it was a retrospective study over 3 decades, showed that patients had no metastasis in level 5 when they had tumors in the tongue, retromolar trigone, and cheek. They found that incidence of level 4 metastasis was very low, only 3% when the patient had elective neck dissection, whereas it has 17% if you had a subsequent neck dissection when the patient developed neck nodes. So basically, the message was again that if you have elective neck dissections, the patients tend to do better with less level, distant, less aggressive tumors, and less level 4 and 5 metastasis. When should you do a neck dissection? This was a seminal paper which suggested that if your probability of having neck nodes is more than 20%, then you should do a neck dissection. And this is Wise paper. This is just so that the PG students remember that 20% is the cutoff. If your incidence of occult metastasis is more than 20%, you need to address the neck surgically. And the seminal paper, which established the role of elective neck dissection as a standard of care from India, this was a 2005 paper, 2015 paper, patients randomized over 10 years. We found that if you do an elective neck dissection, there was an absolute overall survival benefit of 12.5% and a disease-free survival benefit of 23.6%. This has established elective neck dissection as standard of care for oral cavity. And there's a lot of interest in sentinel node biopsy, which seems like a promising technique in a study done across different centers in Europe with good specificity and good negative predictive value, but this is not for the scope of the lecture today. Thank you. I am happy to take any questions. I hope it was not too confusing.
Thank you, ma'am. It was a very informative session. Thank you for giving us tips to preserve important structures and minimize complications. So we will be taking a few questions, ma'am. One of the persons from Hyderabad, Dr. Amjad Khan, wants to have a look again on the relationship between hypoglossal and lingual.
Okay, let me look for a photograph, because in that it was not very clear and it ran off. Can you ask the other question while I try and share screen again?
Dr. Shilpa Matthew from Kottayam, she has asked whether level 5 is divided into A and B by spinal accessory or transverse cervical artery.
It is by the spinal accessory. Transverse cervical artery is the boundary for the level 4.
There is a question from Dr. S.B. Fukan from Guwahati. Is the Delphian node the echelon node for thyroid carcinoma?
The Delphian node can be an echelon node for level, for especially thyroid carcinomas, which are in the upper part of the lobes. So the Delphian node is a pretracheal node which is present above the thyroid.
Another question from Dr. Amjad from Hyderabad. In T1 tongue carcinoma and depth of infiltration is 2 mm, do we still require a neck dissection? I think you have answered this in the research paper.
Yes.
Up to 4 mm, the risk is minimum.
So T1, tongue cancer, right?
Yes. Depth is 2 mm, he's asking.
So in the paper by Tata Hospital, by Dr. De Cruz et al., we did a subgroup analysis and we saw that less than 3 millimeters, there may not be additional benefit of a neck dissection, but this was a post hoc analysis. So really, we don't know whether the recommendation is holds true that you do not need to do a neck dissection. Again, for patients who have 2 millimeter depth of invasion in a T1 tongue cancer, what we would advise is counsel the patient that there is still a chance that you may have a nodal failure only if the patient is ready for a rigorous follow-up with ultrasound and clinical examination every 2 monthly or 3 monthly, would we not do a neck dissection. Still, our recommendations would be to do neck dissection for these patients.
Another question, ma'am, from Guwahati again, on decision of unilateral versus bilateral neck dissection.
Unilateral versus bilateral neck dissection would actually depend on a lot of factors. It would depend on the site of the primary tumor. If it is a midline tumor, like a base tongue tumor, or oropharyngeal tumors, or a supraglottic tumors, you would treat both sides. If the tumor is an oral cavity tumor, which is reaching or crossing midline, you would treat both necks. If there are N3 nodes or there are multiple ipsilateral nodes, it may be prudent to treat the opposite neck as well.
Dr. Rajesh Jain from Bilwara wants to know what is gonion.
Sorry?
Gonion, G-O-N-I-O-N.
G-O-N-I-O-N. Sorry, I have no idea.
Probably it's a typo. Dr. Priyadarshini from Kannur wants you to explain on identification and preservation of spinal accessory again.
Okay, so let me just try and get a picture clip. It might be easier that way. I need to share screen again, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So spinal accessory, she wants it in level 5 or level 2?
I think level 2, level 1B.
I think level 2 probably.
Not the spinal accessory, hypoglossal and...
Yeah, there were two different questions, ma'am.
Okay.
So if you see now in this diagram, the spinal accessory at level 2, so the landmarks for this are the digastric muscle, the posterior belly of the digastric muscle, the sternocleidoid muscle, the internal jugular vein. So the spinal accessory arises from the jugular foramen, from the pars nervosa, comes down underneath the digastric muscle, crosses over most of the time from medially and has two branches. One branch pierces the sternocleidomastoid and supplies the sternocleidomastoid. The other branch goes down along the posterior triangle and goes along the trapezius, anterior border of the trapezius. So this the spinal accessory will have a part which is before the sternocleidomastoid, gives one branch to the sternocleidomastoid, and the other branch goes down, continues and pierces the trapezius, anterior border of the trapezius muscle. So the way to identify the spinal accessory in level 2 is that first of all, dissect out the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid, retract the sternocleidomastoid, open up the carotid sheath, identify the spine, internal jugular vein from below, retract it medially. Then in this space, when you retract the sternocleidomastoid and the IJV, you will start seeing a blood vessel which runs diagonally from medial to lateral. This blood vessel is a branch of the occipital artery which accompanies this spinal accessory nerve. Once you identify that blood vessel, you can actually dissect bluntly using a mosquito or a scissors along parallel to this nerve, and then you can identify this nerve. So this is in level 2. Now when you come to level 5, you need to identify it at Earp's point. Like I said, Earp's point is a point where on the posterior border, the sternocleidomastoid, where all the sensory nerves, the great auricular nerve, the transverse cervical nerve, the supraclavicular nerves exit from the cervical nerve roots and rotate around the spinal posterior border of the sternocleidomastoid and go ahead to give their branches. Now, this confluence is called Earp's point. 1 centimeter above this Earp's point, you will see the spinal accessory underneath the posterior belly of the posterior border of the sternocleidomastoid muscle, which comes outside, lies parallel to the trapezius muscle and goes along and inserts into the anterior border of the trapezius from medial to lateral, 5 centimeters above the clavicle. So identifying the spinal accessory, you should either you can do it from above the clavicle or you can do it 1 centimeter above Earp's point. I hope that answers this question.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, there are 3 questions on skip metastasis of in neck dissection, for especially for tongue carcinomas.
So I didn't talk about that, but Bayer's article is a very quoted article about skip metastasis in tongue carcinoma. They quoted a rate of almost 15% metastasis in level 4 nodes without having corresponding level 2 or 3 nodal metastasis. However, retrospectively, that paper was found to be flawed because a lot of the patients whom they had included in their study were node positive patients. So studies by Dr. Jatin Shah's group, as well as a retrospective prospective study of 593 neck dissections by Tata Hospital, have shown that if you have occult nodal metastasis or no nodes clinical radiologically, the incidence of level 5 metastasis is almost zero. Even if you have nodal metastasis, the incidence of level 5 metastasis is less than 5%. And skip metastasis, that is level 4 metastasis without metastasis in level 2 and level 3, is almost 0%. So I think skip metastasis is overrated. it's very less likely to have skip metastasis like Bayer's paper suggests, and all recent studies after Bayer's articles shows that there is level 4 metastasis will occur only if you have either level 2 or level 3 metastasis.
Another question, ma'am, indication for level 5 node dissection in oral cancer.
Level 5 node dissection in oral cancer, if you have N3 node, if you have multiple level 2, 3, 4 nodes, those are the basic indications in oral cancer. So either you have large nodes, multiple nodes. If you have a if you don't have any node, if it's occult nodal metastasis, there is no indication for level 5 dissection.
Question from Guwahati, ma'am. How would you treat the neck in salvage setting of head and neck cancers?
So when you are treating this neck in salvage setting, is you have to see what is the indication for treating it. Are you treating the neck because there's residual neck node disease, or are you treating it because there's residual primary tumor? Now, if you're talking about surgical steps during salvage, the neck dissection generally is the same. The most precautions you have to take is at the time of raising the skin flaps. These patients who have been radiated in the neck will have reduced vascularity. So again, placing your incisions is very important. Avoid tri-pointers, avoid doing a traditional Kreil's incision or a Schrödinger's incision. If possible, do a single horizontal incision or a McPhee incision. Raise the flap with knife. Do not use a cautery like I've used in the video. Use it with knife and bipolars so that you can preserve all vascularity and not damage vascularity in a radiated neck. The rest of the steps of neck dissection are essentially the same, but you need to be careful because the planes may not be clear, especially if the patient had previous nodal disease and has been radiated. Residual nodal disease, you may injure the internal jugular vein or the carotid artery. So you have to be more cautious while doing that neck dissection.
Ma'am, another question that is on neck dissection in maxillary carcinoma. Level of neck dissection, he wants to know.
So it depends on the type of tumor of and extent of tumor of the maxillary carcinoma. So if it's a true maxillary sinus carcinoma, which is within the sinus, not an alveolar carcinoma, but a sinus carcinoma, there's no indication of doing a upfront neck dissection. For a maxillary sinus carcinoma, when will you do a neck dissection is when the skin is involved. When the tumor has eroded out and come into involving the soft tissues of the skin of the cheek, or the patient has disease in the alveolus and the gingivobuccal sulcus, in such cases you will do a neck dissection, not when it is intra-sinus tumor. If you're talking of an upper gingivobuccal sulcus tumor, you should always treat it with a neck dissection because a gingivobuccal sulcus tumor is an oral cancer and not a maxillary sinus cancer. Remember, first echelon nodes for maxillary sinus is the nodes of Ruvier, or the retropharyngeal nodes, and that generally is not treated surgically.
Ma'am, there are three questions on different thyroid carcinomas, papillary and medullary. All of them asked for prophylactic neck dissection, whether it's required or in N0 cases. Okay.
So now this again depends on what type of carcinoma. So let me start with medullary thyroid carcinomas. For most medullary thyroid carcinomas, you would at least do a central compartment neck clearance if the patient is clinically N0, because these are more aggressive tumors. So the minimum surgery for a medullary thyroid carcinoma will be a total thyroidectomy with central compartment clearance. Obviously, if the patient has neck nodes, then you would do a lateral neck dissection in those patients as well. And that would be a level 2 to 5 neck clearance for medullary thyroid carcinoma. So that is for medullary. If you're talking for papillary thyroid carcinoma, if it is a T1, T2, N0, that is less than 4 centimeters, N0, low risk patient, low risk tumor, that is a classical papillary carcinoma, there is no need to do a prophylactic central compartment neck dissection or a lateral neck dissection. And these are as per the American Thyroid Association guidelines. If you have larger tumors with extra thyroidal extension, or a more aggressive variant of a tumor, you may consider doing at least a central compartment clearance in these patients. If the patient has nodes positive, obviously you have to clear them. Lateral neck dissection is advocated only if you have central compartment nodes which are positive, then ipsilateral neck dissection 2-4 if N0, or 2-5 if node positive.
What is the status of super selective neck dissection?
Super selective neck dissections is a concept followed by some surgeons. This is done as a salvage, in a salvage setting, when the patients have completed chemo RT and has only one level of nodal disease remaining, which is confirmed on PET scan. In such cases, some surgeons would do a super selective neck dissection as removal only of that node. They have, some series have shown good advantage with it, with less morbidity, but it is not something which is uniformly practiced.
Last question, ma'am. They've asked for sinonasal undifferentiated carcinoma, whether the neck dissection is required. I mean, location is not mentioned.
So sinonasal undifferentiated carcinoma is a highly aggressive tumor. A lot of centers would actually treat it upfront with chemo radiotherapy, but surgery would be a part of treatment. Generally, trimodality treatment is required in it. Again, depending management of the neck in sinonasal undifferentiated carcinoma depends on stage of disease and location of disease. So if it is a small T1, T2 tumor, even though it's a high grade, you would not treat the neck if it is a ethmoidal sinonasal undifferentiated carcinoma. If it is something which is eroding skin and a larger tumor, you would then consider doing a neck dissection. So the management of paranasal neck nodes and paranasal sinus tumor is slightly different from oral cavity.
Is the moderator allowed to ask a question, ma'am?
Yeah, sure.
Ma'am, when do you plan to sacrifice the skin intraoperatively?
For the neck nodes or you're talking about generally?
During neck dissection.
So our decision to sacrifice skin is generally made at the outset. We do not do it intraoperatively. That goes without planning. So the reasons why I would sacrifice neck node is mostly because there's fixity of the neck or puckering of the neck, or something what we call a platysma sign, where the platysma is tethered down to the neck and you can see the platysma prominent when the person turns the neck. So if the neck node is otherwise mobile, it will be slightly restricted. If it's fixed, obviously you're not going to operate that neck. If it is restricted and you feel that the neck skin over the node is not moving well, then in such a case, we would plan resecting the skin as a margin. That would be incorporated in the planning of the incision. So we would modify our incision planning depending on the amount of skin we are resecting and the reconstruction of that skin what we are planning.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Bharti ma'am, we don't have more questions now.
Okay.
I just have a comment, Deepa. That was very nice way you tackled all the questions. It tells us that you have a very sound knowledge of the neck, okay, and the head and neck cancers. Keep it up.
Thank you, ma'am.
Very nice talk, Deepa. Deepa, because this is a postgraduate session, how do you identify chyle leak on the table?
So chyle leak on the table, like I said, what we tend to do is we ask the patient anesthetist to do a Valsalva maneuver. By a Valsalva maneuver, what anesthetist does is they lock the circuit, then they give positive pressure ventilation. We put the patient in a Trendelenburg, that's a 15 degree head load position, and then look at the position junction of the internal jugular vein and the subclavian vein. At that point, we look for fluid, which is not slimy, but glistening fluid, which leaks out slowly. And you know that is chyle. Once we identify the point where it is coming out, we generally try and catch it with mosquitoes or a mixture and ligate it. We use non-absorbable sutures to ligate it, so that in case we need to come back there, we identify the site of the leak. Once we've ligated it, we ask our anesthetist again to give a Valsalva to confirm that there's no more leakage of chyle. If we've had a significant amount of chyle leak during the table, after some time we stop seeing the chyle during surgery. So in that case, we just take underrunning sutures or a figure of eight suture and purse-string suture in that area and close it and keep the patient on a fat-free diet postoperatively.
And what precaution you take when you are doing bilateral neck dissections, like regarding the venous, like internal jugular vein?
So the most two or three important things when you are doing a bilateral neck dissection is, one, your incision placement. You have to have your incisions placed in good skin creases so the vascularity of the flap does not get affected. Especially if you're doing something like a visor incision, do not keep something very narrow central pedicle. That will actually necrose and cause loss of skin flap. You try and preserve both external jugular veins so that there's good drainage, both of the both systems, the internal jugular vein as well as the external jugular vein. Try and preserve both on both sides. If not, at least on one side, the external jugular vein should be preserved. By preserving both the external and the internal venous systems, the incidence of facial edema is less. Remember, if you have to sacrifice one internal jugular vein, the intracranial pressure will increase to 3 times. But if you sacrifice both, then the intracranial pressure increases 5 times. The patient has a chance of a venous infarct and can lose life immediately. So if you feel that the node is stuck, you've already sacrificed one internal jugular vein, what we do is back out from surgery and do not proceed with surgery at that point of time. We try to preserve at least one internal jugular vein.
And in radical neck dissection, you start from level 1 and go down, or level 5 and go above?
It doesn't matter, madam. Whether when you're doing a neck dissection, whether you start from 1 to 5 or from 5 to 1, whether you go from posterior to anterior, anterior to posterior, as long as you are doing it systematically, it really does not make a difference. When you're talking about a radical neck dissection, two things you have to be careful is take good stumps on the internal jugular vein above and below, especially below, because if the lower stump slips, then the patient can go into an air embolism immediately. So what we do is doubly ligate the lower end of the IJV and secure it with a transfixation suture so that there's no air embolism. So when you're doing a radical neck dissection, please take stumps on your IJV very carefully.
Did you talk about sentinel lymph node? Because I could not hear.
So I did not, I just brought the concept in, but I have not discussed it in detail because I thought it may not be the scope of this talk. But just for the brief sort of a brief talk about sentinel node is that the concept of sentinel node biopsy is that drainage from a primary tumor occurs in a very systematic stepwise pattern, and the first echelon of the node which will be drained is going to be the sentinel node, or the node which, if you catch that node and that is negative, it's less likely the tumor has spread to any other nodes in the neck. This is true for tumors which are not been treated prior. So that is per-primum tumors. In such cases, the nodal drainage is supposed to form a very systematic stepwise pattern. So if I remove the, like in an oral tongue cancer, the nodal disease will be either at level 1 or 1B or 2. So if I find a node which is there at level 1B or 2, and I remove it, and that is negative for tumor, then I can be assured that it's less likely the tumor has spread to any other neck node. So this is the concept of a sentinel node biopsy. This is done by injecting a radionuclide in the primary tumor and then assessing it with a gamma, the gamma colloid by a counter. I assess the radioactivity in the neck, and you pick up that node which shows a maximum radioactivity, send it for frozen section. If that node on sterile step sectioning shows no tumor, no metastasis, then nothing else is considered. No further neck dissection is required for the patient.
Thank you, Deepa. Excellent talk. You have covered everything, every point, every sentence is, if the postgraduate catches it, he understands, I think he'll be very good with thorough with the knowledge. Thank you, Deepa.
Any questions for Dr. Rupa? I had to leave in between. My internet connection suddenly went off, I got back sometime in between.
Yeah, Dr. Rupa, your talk was very good, very excellent talk. Like the points you made it so simplified, the peritonsillar abscess drainage, like how we can, if at all the forceps is not there. And then the other points which you made, like in a virgin case, even the our good old antibiotic amoxicillin and amoxicillin with clavulanic acid holds good. Only with the, if the patient is treated outside and reports to us, then only the higher antibiotic. That see, all these points the postgraduates has to understand, and because in our dates like education, when they're doing the post-graduation, deep neck spaces, infections, they, you know, sort of they don't give so much of importance. But when we do practice, it is these cases are the problematic ones which we come across and see how the infection, like the viral infection now, how it has taken the entire globe, isn't it? The corona, like that, even the infections, the deep neck spaces, still, I don't know, the Dr. Rupa made a point that the mortality is less, but still we are losing when the mediastinitis happens. We have lost patients, and when the patients to us, we have lost them. Even for the deep neck infections, we have lost these patients. And so the students have to be like, you know, learn these points, what these two speakers have told. They're very good points. You better, again, because all these talks will be uploaded on a web. Whenever they want, they can go back and then see that. I think any other thing, Dr. Samir? Samir?
Madam, if you permit, some questions some questions for Rupa Madam are left. Can you permit?
Go ahead. Yeah, please go ahead.
One doctor is asking where you give incision for parotid space abscess, ma'am.
So the parotid abscess, I mean, I didn't really cover that in my talk. Parotid abscesses, if they're small, they can be actually nowadays more often aspirated. You can do an ultrasound guided aspiration, or you can, do a CT guided aspiration. And in fact, that is what is preferred most of the time. Of course, if it's very large, then you just make a parotid incision, you make over it and widely drain it. If it's the deep lobe of parotid, obviously, then you'll have to go either intraorally or through the neck, one will have to go and incise and drain it.
Okay. Ma'am, one doctor is asking, CT versus MRI in deep neck space infection. CT versus MRI.
You know, an MRI scan would be ideal, but it doesn't make sense. These are sick patients. You want a quick scan, some sort of radiological, diagnosis, evidence of extent. It doesn't make sense to do an MRI scan. Maybe it is of academic importance to have an MRI scan. But I would think a contrast-enhanced CT scan done quickly would probably give you adequate information to proceed with treatment.
Okay. Ma'am, Dr. Shob Mohammed from Bangalore asking, can you tell more about buccal abscess?
So buccal abscesses are related to the buccal space, which is related to the buccinator muscle, will present with a swelling in the oral cavity. You can see in the cheek, actually, cheek region. And isolated buccal abscesses are quite rare. Usually they're in continuity with, say, a masticator space infection. And the drainage is the same for all of these spaces. You go in through one place and then ensure that all the locules are opened up so that the spaces are all drained out.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, you're welcome.
Thank you, Bharti, ma'am, for allowing us.
I thank the speakers and I thank the moderators for taking their time out and joining us today. Samir, we are ending the show now. Vimlesh, I thank Reddy Labs for their cooperation in... Hello, Vimlesh.
We've had a very, very good session today, and thank you to both the speakers and the moderators for this fantastic session. We'll meet again next week, and that will be a session on otology.
Yeah, Samir, we'll have your talk that time. Okay. Yeah.
Okay,
bye. Good night, Rupa.
Thank you very much. Deepa madam, we should thank, in spite of power supply, she could manage the show.
Backup plan.
Yeah,
surgeon should have a backup plan.
In Bombay, we are having, it's pouring. So even my connection just kept on going off repeatedly.
Well, for me, it went off once only. So that's okay. I could come back.
Bye. Okay. Good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Good night. Bye. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you very much. Good night. Thank you very much.
Good night. Good night.